Niki de Saintfort was an artist whose work has had great impact, both internationally and cross-generationally. A major figure in the world of contemporary art. Her art included paintings, performances, theater and graphic design, and filmmaking. Yet it was in the field of sculpture that she reached her apotheosis. Her career developed at a rapid rate. From very early on, the central concept of her art had already been identified: the intense and inextricable relationship between her private life and work.
In my work, I'm condemned to reveal every emotion, thought, and experience. Everything is used: my time, great joys, tragedies and pains. It's all my life. Nothing is secret.
Because she has had no formal art training, Niki de Saintfort's work is often referred to as outsider art, a kind of primitive or naive folk art. Yet it is precisely because she works intuitively from the inside out that the public has so enthusiastically embraced her art.
In this world of so much pain, if a sculpture of mine can give a moment of joy, a moment of life, I feel rewarded.
Who was Niki de Saintfort? An original contributor to 20th century sculpture? A revitalizer of ancient archetypes? An authentic outsider defying the male world? An iconoclastic, egotistical star? A rebellious, idiosyncratic aristocrat? A self-mythologizing and glamorous instrument of God? A generous narcissist in search of salvation? Who was she?
I was born Marie Agnès Fall de Saintfort.
Born into an aristocratic and wealthy Franco-American family in 1930 Paris, Niki de Saintfort was raised and educated in the Upper East Side of New York City.
I was born a baby of the Depression. While my mother was expecting me, my father lost all their money in the crash of 1929. At the same time, she discovered his infidelity. She cried through her pregnancy. I felt those tears. Later, she would tell me that everything was my fault. I would have to prove my mother wrong. Her bad opinion of me was extremely painful and useful to me. I would reject her system of values and create my own. My parents' desire for me was that I should marry a rich and socially acceptable man.
She yearned for freedom in order to escape the restrictions of her family, religious schooling, social status, and expectations.
I painted all the fig leaves of the Greek statues at school with red paint. I was dismissed. The school insisted that I see a psychiatrist. I was worried that I might be insane.
At the age of 18, she fell in love and married a fellow member of her society, Harry Matthews. Seeking to escape their families and their conservative society, they, like other artistically inclined Americans, went to Europe. They settled in Paris, in the middle of a radical French intellectual, political, and cultural upheaval. Niki became a mother, a wife, and had a career as a top fashion model. In 1953, at the age of 23, she had a severe nervous breakdown and emerged from it defiant, aggressive, and obsessed with being an artist.
I was fueled by the desire to live the artistic adventure.
She recovered thanks to her painting, The rather expressionistic and naive gouaches and oils Niki painted during this period until 1955 constitute a family album. Portraits, self-portraits, party and beach scenes, gradually incorporating decorative motifs. As of 1956, her work became more narrative. That was when images of monsters, animals, goddesses, little girls, castles and cathedrals, the moon, the sun, began to emerge. Compositions in which the female figure is central. By 1958, her paintings had become encrusted with stones, beads, broken glass, ceramic fragments, leaves, twigs, mirrors. Broken inside, Niki assembled and kept the pieces, gluing together the fragments of her soul as a representation of life itself. Fragmented, beautiful, broken, assembled, revelatory.
I started to make assemblage works, reliefs with objects, bought toys in stores, found objects at flea markets. There was a lot of aggression in me that was starting to come out. I started putting my violence into my work. I made reliefs of death and desolation. I was starting to descend into hell.
These objects are clear symbols of violence and terror, objects of devastation and death, a symbolic representation of her pain. She exorcised through making art what she was otherwise unable to deal with.
I wanted to forgive my father for trying to make me his mistress when I was 11. I found only rage, passionate hate, and imaginative revenge in my heart. I was so angry with you, Father, disappointed and scared.
In 1960, Niki left her husband and children to pursue her career independently. Not long after, she met the sculptor Jean Tinguely. Tinguely encouraged Niki neither to doubt herself for being a self-taught artist, nor to be afraid of technique. After many long and short-lived affairs, Niki had at last found a man of her own caliber, and no one nor anything would ever equal or replace him. Their love and collaborative relationship endured for more than 30 years, until his death in 1991.
I told Tinguely about my vision to make a painting bleed by shooting at it. Real bullets would pierce the plaster reliefs and hit the cans and bags of paint embedded inside the relief, causing the paint to explode. They were very much like the abstract expressionist paintings that were being done at the same time. It was not only exciting and sexy, but tragic, as though one were witnessing a birth and death at the same moment. I used my own violence to shoot at paintings, murder with no victims. The painting is the victim. It is bleeding. It is wounded. The way people can be wounded. Who was the painting? Daddy? All men? Small men? Tall men? Big men? Fat men? My mother? Patriarchy? Was I shooting at society and its injustices, that my own violence and the violence of the times? I was provoking society through art. I became a terrorist of art. By shooting at my own violence, I no longer had to carry it inside me like a burden. I shot at myself during a ritual which enabled me to die by my own hand and be reborn. I was immortal.
She makes the observer an accomplice of her violence. She involves them in the act of destruction and in the creation of the new picture. With shooting sessions held in Paris, Stockholm, New York, LA, Berlin, and Milan, she gained international notoriety.
Mother, I wanted to conquer the world for you. Everything had to be hidden from you. I would show everything. My heart, my emotions, my pain, my violence, my fears, green, red, hate, love, laughter, tenderness.
My problem is creating beauty, is creating something which has to do with you, which has to do with now, which has to do with bombs and everything exploding and the end of the world.
On the strength of the shooting performances, in 1961 she was invited to join the Nouveau Realistes, becoming the only female member of that important French art movement. Her acceptance by this group of artists, which included Christo, Yves Klein, and Tinkley himself, and with the international press interest in her, it was now clear to her that, although considered by many as marginal to the established art world, she had already conquered her goal of becoming a professional artist. It gave her the confidence she needed. By combining her offensive feminist presence with a strong emphasis on her beauty and femininity, she brought a new powerful element to the voice of her times. At last, before the women's liberation movement of the late 60s and early 70s, a woman was visibly and scandalously resisting everything that formed part of the male dominance and aggression at the exclusion of women.
I could not identify with my female roles. I wanted a heroine to identify with.
A weapon in the hand of a beautiful woman. She was the beauty who challenged the beast of male authority. She appears herself as an archetypal heroine, a modern Amazon, a hunting Diana, recognizing and fighting evil, oppression, and its manifestations. Her creative forces were liberated. She became the heroine she dreamed to be. After the shooting paintings, everything was possible. Rage was gone, and then there was pain and suffering. She started representing elements of a gentler kind, made of baby toys or other small articles, at the same time charming, seductive, useless, and mundane. Hearts, heads, and women in different roles in society. Whores. Pregnant women. Women giving birth. Brides. Niki referred to these female figures as victims, grounded in her own psyche and experiences as a woman.
From provocation, I moved into a more interior, feminine world.
Pain was gone. Then came a new crossroad, a new chapter, the Nanas. Her most apotheotic creations, the archetypal descendants of woman as the earth goddess. The Nanas are voluptuous, joyous creatures, whose generous bodies provided a canvas for bright colors, patchworks of textile, papier-mâché, collage, painted designs, and polyester. Inspired by the pregnancy of a close friend, the nanas, the French slang for chicks, were an expansion of Nikki's own femininity and liberation, representations of a new matriarchal woman in all the aspects that gave her freedom, joy, and power. Men are small compared to the monumental nanas.
Now I am much more concerned with bringing joy.
Ne me laisse pas l'aimer. Pourtant c'est lui que tu veux. Ne me laisse pas l'aimer. Et tu m'oublies peu à peu. Ne me laisse pas l'aimer. Je sais qu'un jour viendra, tu tomberas dans ses bras. Ne me laisse pas l'aimer. Mais il est déjà trop tard. Ne me laisse pas l'aimer. Mais tu l'aimes déjà. Ne me laisse pas l'aimer. Un jour, il fera mouche. Tu tomberas sur sa bouche. Tu ne peux pas résister quand il vient te parler. Je vois tes yeux qui s'accrochent à ses yeux. Non, tu ne peux pas résister. Il sait que c'est plus fort que toi. Et comme il te veut, un jour il t'aura.
Ne me laisse pas l'aimer.
Mais tu te prends à son jeu.
Ne me laisse pas l'aimer.
Il est bien trop dangereux.
Ne me laisse pas l'aimer.
Oh non, tu ne vois pas comme il s'amuse de toi.
In 1966, Nikki was invited to build a monumental sculpture at the Moderna Museet of Stockholm. This giant reclining penetrable nana was named Han, or she in Swedish.
I was going to build the biggest nana of all, a great pagan goddess. I painted her with the very bright, pure colors I have always used and loved. I knew I was entering the sacred land of myth. She was like a grand fertility goddess, receiving, absorbing, devouring 100,000 visitors comfortably in her generosity and immensity. She was the greatest whore in the world. There was something magical about her. The birth rate in Stockholm went up that year. This was attributed to her. Everyone who saw her broke into a smile. She couldn't help but make us feel good.
The hone existed for only 3 months and then was destroyed. She was never meant to stay. She had a short but full life.
If life is a game of cards, we are born without knowledge of the rules, yet we must play our own hand. In 1955, I went to Barcelona. There I saw Gaudi's beautiful Parc Güell. I dreamt of building a garden that would be a dialogue between sculpture and nature, a place to dream in. A garden of joy and fantasy, where people would come to be uplifted, diverted, bewitched. 24 years later, I would embark on the biggest adventure of my life, the Tarot Garden.
In 1979, with the help of her close friend Mirella Agnelli, the wife of Italian tycoon Gianni Agnelli, Nikki is granted the use of a plot of land belonging to Mirella's brothers, close to the seashore in the south of Tuscany. She labored for more than 15 years to create a monumental fantasy garden, where the 22 archetypal symbols of the tarot are represented in an infinite variety of materials, a sublime union between art and nature.
As soon as I started on the tarot garden, I realized it was going to be a perilous journey. This garden was made with difficulties, love, wild enthusiasm, obsession, and most of all, faith. Nothing could stop me. Total immersion was the only way to realize this garden. Maybe art is more about obsession and less about talent than people think.
In order to finance her $5 million dream, Niki needed to find new resources. She raised the necessary funds with the help of friends' donations, yet it was a Niki de Saint-Phalle perfume contained in a bottle designed by her that paid for nearly one-third of the total cost of the garden.
The loneliness, the technical, bureaucratic, and financial problems inherent to an art project of this scale only enlarged my vision. I was struck with severe arthritis and could barely walk or use my hands. Yet I went on. I was bewitched. The beauty of horror. I watched my hands becoming deformed, the disease progressing. I couldn't sculpt anymore. My intelligence remained, along with my imagination and my eyes. The idea came to me that God really loved me and chose me to make this garden. I was simply an instrument.
The Magician.
The card of God, the creator of the universe.
The Sun.
I have conceived of the sun as a bird, the creature closest to it.
Death.
The greatest mystery of life. Without death, life would have no meaning.
The World.
The splendor of interior life.
The Fool.
Man on his spiritual quest.
The Oracle. The Hierophant.
The priest who deciphers mysteries.
The Hermit.
Compassionate, the hanged man sees the world in a new way.
Strength.
A frail maiden leads a ferocious dragon by an invisible thread. The monster the maiden must tame is inside herself. It is her own inner demon she must conquer. Through this difficult task, she will discover her own strength.
The Empress.
The great goddess. She is the queen of the sky. Mother. Hor. Emotion. Sacred magic and civilization. I lived for years inside the protective mother. I made it my home and the center of the garden. It was where I met the crew, ate my meals, and made the models for the other cards.
At last, her lifelong dream to live inside a sculpture came true, an undulating round space without any right angles to threaten and attack her.
I wanted to invent a new mother, a mother goddess, and in these forms be reborn.
The Emperor.
Card of masculine power, for good or bad. He represents the patriarch or male protector. The Emperor is a symbol of organization and aggression. He is brought as science and medicine, but also weapons and war. If I had not concretized my dreams into sculptures, I might have become possessed by them, a victim of my own visions.
The boundaries between real and unreal, her conscious and her unconscious, are nebulous, permeable, and her art is a bridge between them. The materials are colorful, diverse, easy to understand, touchable, and playful. Mirrored sculptures reflect nature, reflect the other sculptures. They reflect ourselves. They merge with the surroundings, as opposed to works of art in a museum. They become alive. They expand in format and in meaning. The universe of colors, surfaces, materials, and reflections of these archetypal and mythological images dazzle the eyes and the minds of those who see and enter them. They invite us to participate in their world, to explore her art. They bring out the inner child in us. They calm our anxieties, real or imaginary. They make us discover poetry and fairy tales. They reflect our own unconscious dreams.
The tarot has given me a greater understanding of the spiritual world and of life's problems, and also the awareness that each difficulty must be overcome, so that one can go on to the next hurdle and finally reach inner peace in the garden of paradise.
In 1993, at the age of 63, due to increasing health problems, Niki moved permanently to Southern California. Now an internationally acclaimed artist, she focused her creative energy on public sculptures, with several important commissions in California, Europe, and Israel.
Art can exist outside society, without intermediaries, without museums, without galleries.
Plain and fantastic, lonely together, painfully tender like the first roll of thunder. You are sweet and slow, Creole, Creole, Creole. You are veiled and bold, Creole, Creole, Creole. The warm and the sharp breeze, movement and solace, you are the soft shine of lightning. I just go walking in the rain when I feel you in the sky. I just go walking in the rain.
In her work, there is a freedom to expand oneself. It is an invitation to curiosity, to spontaneity, to play, an invitation into childhood. Most importantly, it is an invitation to face one's greatest fears. And by facing our greatest fears, we encounter our true selves.
I've learned through my art to tame the things that scare me.
In the year 2000, Niki generously offered to design and build at her own expense a site-specific sculpture park in the city of Escondido, California. The park, inaugurated in 2003, will be not only the largest collection of her public artwork in the United States, but also her last creation.
I feel that the part of me that stayed a child is the artist in me.
What liberated her, her art, is what eventually killed her. The material she most loved to work, polyester, became her lethal enemy, causing severe damage to her lungs. After 6 months of being in intensive care, Niki de Saintfall was finally released of her suffering. She died on May 21st, 2002, at the age of 71. Her work lives on, and her greatest legacy was her very own personal journey, represented through her art, from rage to pain and suffering to regeneration and joy.